Good afternoon. If everybody wants to be seated, we'll start in about a minute. Of course, it got quiet. So. I wanted to say welcome to everyone. Melissa and I are so happy you've joined us in celebrating this milestone in Amelia's life. It's been a great privilege to be her parents and watch her grow into a bright, confident, funny, curious, diligent, kind young woman. We're going to miss her greatly when she moves on to continue her education at Mississippi State University in August. And it's in gratitude to God's faithfulness in these first 17 years of her life, and great confidence in his continued blessing as she heads off to new adventures that we gather today. Please join me in prayer. Most merciful Father, we come to you full of thanksgiving and hope. Thank you for the many people who have had a hand in Amelia's education, her professors at Calhoun Community College, her instructors at STEM Academy, her teachers and mentors at this church, adult friends, family members, and especially Melissa. We thank you for growing Amelia in heart, mind, soul, and strength, and for her firm foundation in her love for you. Bless our time here today, and show us how we can support her as she transitions to her next stage of life. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. Please stand for the processional.
Isaiah 40:28-31. Have you not known? Have you not heard? The Lord is the everlasting God, the creator of the ends of the earth. He does not faint or grow weary. His understanding is unsearchable. Even youth shall he gives power to the faint, and to him who has new might he increases strength. Even youth shall faint and grow weary, and young men shall fall exhausted. But they who wait for the Lord shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings like eagles. They shall run and not be weary. They shall walk and not faint.
Amelia, I really agonized over what to say for this. So if you hate it, please just don't tell me. And I agonized over it, not because I'm unaccustomed to giving charges to seniors. I have some practice with that. But because I consider it no small privilege to get to speak to you specifically in this moment. It's one thing to speak to a small group or to a crowd, but another altogether to, even if it's just for a few brief minutes, ignore the crowd and speak with great intention to one person. And that's what I want to do. I want to ignore every other person in this room, and I want to talk to you. Amelia, when I met you, you were entering the second semester of your seventh grade year. And two things struck me about you pretty quickly. The first is that I'm pretty sure you're already taller than me, which kind of hurt my feelings. And the second, and much more importantly, I recognized that you were much smarter, much more insightful, much more quick-witted than you ever seemed to give yourself credit for. You had immense talent and potential in countless ways, but at least to me, it always looked like you either felt the need to hide it or that you didn't know you had it. Now, any number of things can play into this. Certainly, there have been countless middle school students who lacked appropriate confidence or were happy to fade into the background. You're also by nature on the quiet, introverted side. which is a wonderful thing. It helps give shape to your particular gifts and your thoughtfulness and your truly killer comedic timing. But whatever the reason or reasons, you at least appeared to be unsure of just how many talents you had at your disposal. Happily, in the intervening years, one of the most significant ways I've seen God grow you is in this very area. And it's honestly been fun for me to watch you come into your own. You speak up and your peers listen. You've taken the time to develop skill sets and things like video editing and coding and cybersecurity and about a dozen other things that I don't know anything about, but love to hear you discuss because you're so clearly competent and passionate. You know how to lean into your strengths, but you do so with great humility, which is a tricky balance to strike. But many of these strengths you possess and the skills you've learned are double-edged swords. They can cut two ways. While you've rightfully grown confident in so many areas, it would not be hard to let that confidence turn into something selfish. I should note before I give these examples that I've never seen any hint of these things in you. I only want to highlight a potential danger here. You could very easily use your quick wit to cut people down or push them away. You could lean into your intelligence to make others feel small. You could hide behind your interests and expected occupation to avoid having to serve or care for other people. And it would probably have little, if any, bearing on whether or not you're professionally successful. In fact, I suspect you're looking at a very successful future no matter what. I wouldn't bet against you. But in all your success, you could build, dwell in, and attempt to rule a kingdom that exists only to make much of yourself. You could spend your life in a nearly impenetrable citadel with a population of one. But it doesn't have to be that way. There's another option. In a passage from Philippians 2, with which I'm sure you are very familiar, Paul writes this: "So, if there is any encouragement in Christ, any comfort from love, any participation in the Spirit, any affection and sympathy, complete my joy by being of the same mind, having the same love, being in full accord and of one mind. Do nothing from selfish ambition or conceit, but in humility count others more significant than yourselves. Let each of you look not only to his own interests, but also to the interests of others. Have this mind among yourselves, which is yours in Christ Jesus, who, though he was in the form of God, did not count equality with God a thing to be grasped, but emptied himself by taking the form of a servant, being born in the likeness of men, and being found in human form, he humbled himself by becoming obedient to the point of death, even death on a cross. If you have any encouragement," he writes, "any at all in Christ, then do nothing from selfish ambition. Have this mind which is already yours in Christ. If there is anything in you, anything that is even a little bit moved, a little bit touched by the fact that Jesus Christ, the God-man, went to the cross for you, Amelia, you in particular, to make you right with God, then be controlled by the same humility and service he showed you in this love. But what does that look like for you in your context and the world you're going into? Well, I mentioned a few of the ways that your strengths or your interests could go off the rails, but that's really only going to happen if you view them entirely through the lens of self-interest. In service to God and to others, you could use your humor and quick wit not to cut people down, but to make them feel welcomed. You could use your intelligence to teach. You could use your confidence to cover for, protect, and encourage those who haven't quite found any for themselves yet. You could use the skill sets you've gained in video editing and coding and cybersecurity to move toward people who share those interests, but due to how easy it is to engage them alone, might be starved for friendships. I mentioned before that you're introverted, and I hope you know that I don't mean to use this charge to tell you to be something you're not. I only mean to remind you that there are people who are now where it seems you were not too many years ago. I know you well enough to know that you could go a pretty long time before feeling like you need a bunch of people in your life. Now, I'd quickly add that you do need them, and you would need them before you realized it. But you probably wouldn't feel that need too terribly intensely at first. However, there will be other people who need you. And in God's grace, he has uniquely positioned you, to love them. So this is my charge to you, Amelia. If you find any encouragement at all in the love of Christ for you, have the same mind which is yours in him, to in humility count others more significant than yourself, to look not only to your own interests, but to the interests of others, and to, like the Savior who has loved you, take the form of a servant. Please pray with me. Gracious God, we give thanks for the many ways you've grown and equipped Amelia so far. You've been kind to her, and in letting us be a part of her life, you've been immeasurably kind to us. We pray now that you would continue the beautiful work you've begun. Grant her the grace and wisdom to hone and use her gifts to the best of her ability for your glory and the good of her neighbors. We pray you'd bless the work of her hands, grant her success, and give her the endurance and courage to face the opposition and obstacles that she'll face. In all these things, though, our greatest prayer, our greatest desire for her is that you would do only what you promise and keep conforming her more and more into the likeness of her Savior, Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen.
Amelia Grace McMahon, in light of your exceptional scholarship and disciplined determination in pursuing educational excellence, we are pleased to present you with this diploma certifying your graduation with honors from Ambleside Classical School. May the Lord bless you and keep you.
Well, first off, I'd like to thank you all for coming here today to support me. It means so much that you give up your Sunday afternoon to watch me get a diploma and attempt a graduation speech. I'm guessing some of you just came because of the cake, and I can't say I blame you. Regardless, I'm thankful for every one of you here, and I promise to be brief so we can get to the cake. I must confess, it was difficult settling on a topic for the speech. Mom just told me to choose a topic I wanted to talk about, so I hope you're all excited to discuss quantum mechanics and how it illustrates the general uncertainty yet predictability of the future as it relates to high school graduation. I'm kidding, I really wish I wasn't, but I'm kidding. I could also go on for a long time about the themes of redemption and revenge in The Count of Monte Cristo, one of my favorite classic novels, and contrast it with these same themes in Les Mis, another of my favorite classics. Or I could talk about the ideas in a little-known but highly influential book I read in ninth grade, Character's Destiny by Russell Goff. I even considered talking about my newfound interest in editing anime music videos and how it is a valid form of digital choreography despite what YouTube keeps telling me. The truth is, I've always been curious about many different aspects of the world, and I've been blessed that my education has allowed me to dive deeper into those varied interests, especially between the sciences and humanities. In our homeschooling, we tend to follow the educational philosophy of the 19th century British educator Charlotte Mason. Her philosophy holds that children are born persons, and that has formed how our family has approached education. One of our favorite quotes from Charlotte Mason sums up not just the breadth of what education should look like, but also the ultimate goal in what education should be. She wrote, "Our aim in education is to give a full life. The question is not how much does the youth know when he has finished his education, but how much does he care? And about how many orders of things does he care? In fact, how large is the room in which he finds his feet set? And therefore, how full is the life he has before him?" My final exams in my traditional classes have pretty much been centered on how much I know. It's good to know stuff. I want the engineers who build bridges and the surgeons who cut people open to know stuff. But I'm glad I've had an education that also values a great many things. Things like fulcrums and fuetes, relativity and the Reformation, cybersecurity and classical music. The humanities make us more human and set us up to explore our world, not exploit it. So I'm always surprised when I find that sharp distinction drawn between humanities and science, when in reality, they're two sides of the same coin. Let's consider it. On one hand, there's science, full of things like structures, processes, numbers, and equations. On the other hand, there's art, more creative and abstract and colorful. We're conditioned to separate them, arts and sciences, STEM and the extras. Especially in education, we're often encouraged to focus on math and science as the real subjects, defined in a utilitarian way as the ones that might get you a good paying job, and see the arts as extras, nice to have, but maybe something we can live without. I disagree. Arts and sciences go hand in hand to help us be more fully human, to better understand our creator and our fellow humans. I know I'm a nerd, but there's an art to math. You know when you're solving an equation and everything's canceling out and you can see all the pieces just falling together into that beautiful, perfect answer? Or when you're staring at the periodic table, wondering who in their right mind found all these perfect connections between elements and arranged them in such a beautiful and efficient way? Or learning about the mathematical constants involved in the physical universe, the logic and theory behind musical composition. There's an art to science and a science to art. Look at the ratios that are everywhere. Look at architecture. How much math went into building the pyramids, cathedrals? Things like these are where art and science intersect, and isn't it beautiful? It makes me wonder what happened to divide art and science so strongly. Anyone who knows me knows ballet is my art. Throughout middle school and about half of high school, I was the walking excuse of, I can't, I have dance, and I loved it. I may not be able to sing or draw or act or write, but I can express artistry through dance. Throughout my years of dance training, I've noticed something. The more I learn in math and different sciences, the better I understand the art of dance. The amount of physics that goes into any sport, not just ballet, is amazing. Of course, bringing my arms in when I turn makes me go faster. That's literally angular momentum. Simultaneously rotating both inner thigh muscles produces torque, which is what creates proper turnout. Understanding physics and anatomy made me a better dancer, and vice versa. Art and music require thinking outside the box, looking at the world perhaps a little differently. Practicing and honing technique allows that breakthrough of genius, of artistry, of discoveries one might not make when only focusing on the process. I know that my education won't end with receiving this diploma or any other diploma in 4, maybe 5 years. I am thankful that I do have a full life set before me, as Charlotte Mason envisioned, and that I do find myself in a large room with many orders of things I care about. And I hope that this life will continue to be one marked with curiosity and connection, and ultimately, that it will point to the Creator. To that end, I would ask that you would join me in the beautiful hymn, which is also my prayer, "Be Thou My Vision," printed on the back of your programs.
In just a moment, we will hear one last good word of benediction, which will conclude the worship part of our service this afternoon, after which you are invited to join us in the gathering area for our reception and the cake that Amelia promised. One quick note, again, after the benediction and the conclusion of the worship service, Amelia and her family and me will recess in a very particular way. We ask that you would recess in kind. Now, please hear one last good word from the Lord. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face to shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord lift up his countenance upon you and give you peace. Amen.